Subscribe to LearnCab and hit the bell icon to get notified.
The next change is in the chapter Taxable Event Supply. So friends, we have divided supply into four parts: actual supply, deemed supply. After it being classified either as an actual supply or a deemed supply, whether it is a supply of goods or a supply of services, the classification, the third part. And there are certain transactions which are neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services. So those transactions are there in Schedule 3. There are 8 activities. And Section 7, Subsection 2, Clause B states that the GST Council can recommend certain activities to be neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services, and the government will notify those activities to be neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services. Now friends, so far there were two activities which were notified under Section 7, Subsection 2, Clause B. Now there is an additional activity which is there, so totaling to 3 activities which are neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services. Now first let's have a look, a brief catch up of what those two activities were there, and then we go on to the third activity. So neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services, Schedule 3, 8 cases. Notified cases, earlier there were 2, 1 is increased and now it becomes 3. The amendment is with regard to this incremental 1. Now friends, the earlier 2 which was there, one was any interstate movement between distinct persons of modes of conveyances. That was neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services. Now that could be for repairs or maintenance, but however, if the repair and maintenance which is being done, that would classify as a supply. I hope you are aware of this. The next notified activities was any transactions which was undertaken by the government, either the central government or state government or a local authority, in which they are engaged as a public authority, and which activities, if they are carrying out those activities which are originally entrusted to either a municipality or a panchayat under Article 243 W or G of the Constitution. Now the third case. The third case, which is the amendment, which is notified by notification number 25/2019 Central Tax Rate, it reads, service by way of grant of alcoholic liquor license against consideration in the form of license fee or application fee or by whatever name it is called. Now friends, as we all know, alcoholic liquor is outside GST. Liquor, that is any supply of liquor, it is outside GST, it doesn't attract GST. It happens to be a non-taxable supply. Constitutionally, as regards as alcoholic liquor is concerned, constitutionally it is outside GST. Now friends, if at all you want to serve liquor, you need to obtain a license from the state government. If you want to serve liquor, you need to obtain a license from the state government, because liquor happens to be a list 2 item. That is, in the Constitution, Article 246, Schedule 7, List 2, the state list, it contains alcoholic liquor. So therefore, you need to obtain a permission, a license from the state government if you want to serve liquor. Now friends, this activity of the state government giving the license to any business person for serving liquor, is this a supply or is this outside GST? Now this activity of the state government giving the license against a consideration, a permission to serve liquor, this is not outside GST. It is not a supply of alcoholic liquor. It is giving license to serve the liquor further. So this activity of the state government, of course, according to Section 2, Clause 17, it happens to be business, because any activities which are undertaken by the government, even when they are engaged as public authorities, also is business. So therefore, this happens to be a business, it is for consideration, and it is a supply of service. So therefore, it happens to be a supply of service. Now, friends, we are discussing about the scenario. What if 25/2019 central tax rate was not there? What if this notification was not there? In such cases, the state government would provide a license to serve liquor against a consideration that happens to be business, that happens to be supply, and it is taxable. And friends, as we all know, any services which is supplied by the government to the business entity, most of those services are taxable under reverse charge mechanism. So that business entity was supposed to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism for obtaining the liquor license. Say for example, there is a restaurant which is having an attached bar, and in that bar liquor is being served. So in order to that restaurant wants a permission to serve the liquor in the bar, yearly it should pay a license fee and obtain a license and keep on renewing that license on a yearly basis. It is a supply of service which is taxable under GST under reverse charge mechanism had this notification not been there. Now, by virtue of this notification 25/2019 central tax rate, it reads that any service by way of grant of alcoholic liquor license against a consideration in the form of license fee or application fee or by whatever name called is neither a supply of goods nor a supply of service. So the implication is, since it becomes neither a supply of goods nor a supply of service, that business entity is not required to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism on this particular transaction. Now friends, it has to be clearly understood. It has to be clearly understood that not all the license fees which are given by the government against a consideration are included in this notification. This notification is very, very specific only with respect to alcoholic liquor license. So any other license which is given against a consideration, let's suppose the government is giving a license, a right to exploit the natural resources, that is for a consideration, it happens to be a supply and it is not covered under 25/2019. So friends, the purpose of 25/2019 will not have any precedence value on the other licenses which are being given. That will be taxed accordingly, according to what is there, whether it happens to be a supply. If it is covered by an exemption notification, it would be exempted. Otherwise, it is going to be a supply, which is going to be taxable under reverse charge mechanism. Now friends, if you look into all those three cases which are notified under section 7 subsection 2 clause B to be neither a supply of goods nor a supply of services, two cases have some purpose. This one case doesn't have any purpose. Say for example, those two cases, any interstate movement of modes of conveyances between distinct persons, there was an hardship which was caused to the assessee because each time the conveyance moved, an invoice needs to be raised and GST needs to be paid. So that due to that hardship, that activity was notified neither to be a supply of goods nor a supply of services. The activity number two, it was basically for public welfare, when the government is undertaking the activities which were originally entrusted to a panchayat or a municipality and they are engaged as public authorities. So it is basically for public welfare. So activities one and two, which was already there, they had some purpose. This third activity doesn't have any purpose. It is merely a private agreement. It is merely a private understanding between the state government and the central government, wherein they have mutually agreed to decide not to tax alcoholic liquor license under GST. Otherwise, it doesn't serve any purpose. And please bear in mind, this 25/2019 will cover only and only alcoholic liquor license. The next, in the case of supply, there's a circular 116-35-2019. It speaks about donations. Are donations liable to be taxed under GST? Now friends, let's say there's a charitable trust. Now a donor on his son's birthday, let's suppose there's a donor who donates an amount of 1 lakh rupees to this charitable trust. Now, this charitable trust receives this 1 lakh rupees. The question is this receipt of 1 lakh rupees, is it taxable under GST? Now, friends, as we all know, the basic requirement for activity to qualify as a supply is there should be an activity which should be for business and which should be for consideration. We'll ignore deemed supply as of now. We'll just discuss about the actual supply, section 7, subsection 1, clause A. Any activity which is for business and for consideration, it happens to be a supply. Now friends, this charitable trust is receiving 1 lakh rupees. Friends, please bear in mind the difference. Receiving money is different and receiving consideration is different. Receipt of money of 1 lakh rupees is a different scenario, and when that money takes the nature of consideration, it becomes a different scenario, and only then it is taxable to be a supply. What is the difference between receiving money and receiving consideration? Receiving consideration means you are obligated to do something in return for the receipt of that money. That partakes the character of consideration, and only then it could qualify as a supply. Now friends, on the son's birthday, a person is donating 1 lakh rupees to this charitable trust. This is merely receipt of money. We cannot call it as a receipt of consideration. We cannot call it as a receipt of consideration because by receiving this 1 lakh rupees, the charitable trust doesn't have any contractual reciprocity. It doesn't have any obligation to perform some activity, to do something. So therefore, even though it has received a money of 1 lakh rupees, this cannot be called as a consideration because there is no contractual reciprocity. There is no obligation which is there on this charitable trust. So hence, it cannot qualify as a supply and it is not taxable accordingly. Now friends, let's say there's a corporate which is donating some 25 lakh rupees to this charitable trust for the purpose of construction of, let's say, an auditorium. A corporate donates rupees 25 lakh for the purpose of construction of an auditorium in this charitable trust. Now the condition of this corporate is, the condition of this corporate who's giving a donation of 25 lakh rupees is, in front of the auditorium there should be a name board. There should be a name board which should display that we are grateful to this, let's say, ABC Limited Company. We are grateful to ABC Limited Company for having sponsored the construction of this auditorium, or in whatever way the name of corporate is advertised. So there is a condition and based upon which this corporate is giving a donation of 25 lakh rupees. Now friends, the question is whether this donation of 25 lakh rupees which is being received by this charitable trust, does it amount to a supply? Now friends, is there an activity? The answer is yes. The activity which is done by the charitable trust is displaying or advertising the name of the corporate. So it is essentially advertisement services which are given for a consideration. Now friends, what difference does it make in example 1 and example 2? In example number 1, the charitable trust was not under any obligation. The charitable trust was not under any obligation to display the name of the donor. So it was merely receiving 1 lakh rupees, not under any obligation. That money did not partake the character of a consideration. But let's say when this corporate is giving 25 lakh rupees to this auditorium with the condition stating that there should be a name board which should display the name of the sponsor, the advertisement of this company should happen. So essentially it partakes the characteristics, this money partakes the characteristics of a consideration and it happens to be a supply for consideration. It is an advertisement services which is supplied by this charitable trust. Now friends, having said so, this is what the circular is speaking about, 116/35/2019, which states that if the donation is received and there is in turn any obligation which needs to be fulfilled by this charitable trust, it happens to be a consideration and it happens to be a supply and it is taxable under GST. Now friends, having said so, but this case is very, very subjective. I'll just discuss what happens in practical life. In practical life, what happens is, let's suppose if this corporate is even donating this 25 lakh rupees and on the name board, before the auditorium, on the name board, the name of this corporate, let's say ABC Limited, is being advertised. Now there could be a stand which is taken by this corporate stating that I donated 25 lakh rupees. I agree that I donated 25 lakh rupees. I also agree that there is a name board in front of the auditorium which is displaying my name. But I never asked the charitable trust to display this name. The charitable trust was under no obligation to display this name. Rather, this donation was never given with such a condition. Now, charitable trust on its own, as a measure of its gratitude, it has displayed our name and it has done this on a voluntarily basis. Even if it would not have done, we had no issues in that. So it is as a matter of courtesy, as a matter of gratitude, the charitable trust has displayed this name. So in this case, there is no obligation on the part of the charitable trust to display the name of the donor. If this is proven, then again, this is mere money which will not partake the characteristic of a consideration and it will not amount to be a supply. So these cases are very subjective, but for examination purpose, what you need to remember is only so much. If there is any obligation on the charitable trust to do anything in return of the donation which is being received, then it becomes a supply. If it is not obligated due to anything, it doesn't be a supply. So friends, levy of GST on the service of display of name or placing of the nameplates of the donor in the premises of a charitable organization receiving the donation or gifts by individual donors. Here the circular tells, no GST liability if, there will be no GST liability if gift or donations are made to charitable organizations, payment has the characteristics of a gift or a donation, and it is for philanthropic purposes. So if all the three conditions are satisfied, then there is no GST liability upon the charitable trust which it has to be discharged. So now friends, even though the circular speaks only about donations made to charitable organization, let's have a look at these three conditions. It tells you the gift or donation should be made to a charitable organization. The payment should have the characteristic of a gift or a donation. That means gift or a donation means there is no obligation upon the charitable trust to do something in return. What do you mean by gift or a donation? A gift or a donation means the person who is receiving it, he doesn't have any obligation to perform anything. Only then it becomes a gift or a donation. Otherwise, it becomes contractual reciprocity if he is having some obligation to do anything in return. And it is given for philanthropic purposes and not for advertisement purposes. So now friends, even though this circular states that only if these three conditions are satisfied, the donation would qualify not to be taxed under GST. But however friends, you can stretch this circular further. If the gift or donation is made even to non-charitable organizations, if it is made to any person and there is no contractual reciprocity which is there on the recipient, even then it will not be liable to GST. So even though this speaks only about charitable organization, this concept could be extended elsewhere also. But however friends, we have to be very, very careful. The carefulness in sense, let's suppose there are certain goods. There are certain goods which are donated to this charitable organization and it is in the form of donation. The charitable organization is not obliged to do anything, for the purpose of receiving these goods. But however, just by reading this circular 116/35/2019, even though all these three conditions might be satisfied, that is, it is a gift or a donation and it is for philanthropic purposes, no advertisement services are given, but still, just by reading this circular on a standalone basis, you cannot conclude that it is not taxable under GST, because you have to read this with schedule number 1 of the CGST Act, para number 1, which tells that permanent transfer or disposal of business assets on which input tax credit has been taken will be liable to GST. It is going to be a deemed supply. So now friends, these goods which are given as a donation, if on these goods, if input tax credit was availed by this organization, it partakes the characteristics of a deemed supply under section 7, subsection 1, clause C, schedule 1, para number 1. So friends, this circular cannot be read in isolation. Subject to all other conditions of section 7 not being supplied, subject to all other conditions of section 7 not getting attracted, if it is a gift without any obligation on the charitable trust to do something in return, then there is no tax on this transaction of donation. The next amendment in case of reverse charge, few entries have been amended and there are few new entries which are there in this chapter of reverse charge. Let's go with the amended entry. Copyright. Now friends, as regards as the services which are supplied by an author to a publisher, before amendment, that is prior to 1st of October, it was mandatorily under reverse charge mechanism. Now how this entry is amended? After 1st of October, it is optionally under reverse charge mechanism. Prior to 1st of October 2019, services by an author to a publisher wherein the consideration is received in the form of royalty, it was mandatorily under reverse charge mechanism. From 1st of October 2019, it has become optionally under reverse charge mechanism. That means the author can also opt to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. Now friends, I'll tell you a brief background as to what could be the intention behind bringing this amendment. Now friends, if you look into the publisher, so here there's an author who supplies services to the publisher and receives royalty in return. Now this publisher is going to further supply the books which are authored by this author. And now friends, this supply of books, it is an exempted supply under GST. Please understand, the supply of books by the publisher in the market, it is not taxable, it is an exempted supply. However, supply of services by an author to the publisher, it is not exempted, it is taxable. Let's say it carries a rate of tax at 12%. Now friends, kindly correlate this with input tax credit section 17, what you have learnt. As regards to Section 17 is concerned, any inward supply which is exclusively used for making an exempt supply, can you take input tax credit? The answer is no. Input tax credit cannot be taken for those supplies which are purely exempted. Now, this services by an author to a publisher which is used exclusively for making an exempt supply, credit cannot be taken. So, this 12% GST, it becomes a cost. Now, friends, the moot question, the tussle of money which comes is, who should bear this 12%? Should this 12% be the responsibility of the publisher? Of course, it is under reverse charge mechanism. We are discussing about a scenario prior to 1st of October 2019, wherein it was mandatorily under reverse charge mechanism. So now the publisher had to pay 12% to the government. The compliance portion, the publisher had to do. We are not discussing about the compliance portion. He needs to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism. He needs to file the returns. All that is fine. But this 12%, what he's paying under reverse charge mechanism, can he recover it from the author? Or can he make an adjustment in the royalty which is being paid? This GST law is silent. It is a private contract. So now, friends, since this 12% becomes a cost, now had these books which are being supplied, had these been taxable, this 12% would not have become a cost because credit would have been available. Now, since the books are exempted, this 12% GST paid on royalty, it becomes a cost. Now, there is a huge fight between the author and the publisher as to who should bear this 12%. So, the publisher would say, I will pay 12% to government. It is my responsibility because it is mandatory under reverse charge prior to 1st of October. For your examination, it is optional reverse charge mechanism. We will see that what are those conditions. But we are just discussing the background. So, now, this publisher would say, this 12% I will comply, I will pay to the government, but this 12% I will adjust it against your royalty. So now friends, those authors who are very famous and who can dominate the publisher, they would not agree and the publisher has to bend down and bear this 12%. However, those authors who are new in the field, who are not so very famous, they would be forced to bear this 12%. So then the royalty would have been adjusted. So therefore friends, what they have bought is from mandatory reverse charge mechanism, they have bought it to optional reverse charge mechanism. That means if the author wants, the author should opt to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism, then these services will be taxed under forward charge mechanism. If the author does not opt to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism, then it would be the publisher who would be liable to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. So friends, practically how it works is, if the publisher is dominant, and the author is not so famous, then the publisher would force the author to opt to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism. He would force the author that he opts to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. That means this 12% will become the responsibility, the liability, the cost of the author. So whatever royalty is being paid by the publisher to the author, on that 12%, the author will have to shell out additional money to the government. However, if the author happens to be dominant as compared to the publisher, if the author is a very famous author, in such case, he would say, I will not opt to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. Here, the publisher would be forced to shell out that 12%. So friends, it is all a private contract as to who is going to pay taxes, whether it is under forward charge or it is under reverse charge. But as regards as GST law is concerned, who should choose this option? It is totally a private contract, but who has to choose this option? The option has to be chosen by the author. The publisher cannot say, I will not pay under reverse charge mechanism, let the author pay. It will not work that way. The author has to take registration and he has to give a declaration that he will pay taxes under forward charge mechanism, and on the invoice which is raised by the author to the publisher, he would clearly mention that these taxes are being paid under forward charge mechanism. If the author doesn't take registration, or after taking registration doesn't give such a declaration, in such cases it would be the publisher's liability which is taxable under reverse charge mechanism. So friends, the default route is, after the amendment with effect from 1st of October 2019, the default route is reverse charge mechanism. Services supplied by an author to a publisher who is located in taxable territory, the default answer is reverse charge mechanism. However, if the author is registered and if he gives a declaration that he opts to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism, then there is a deviation in the default route and the author would pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. So friends, here we go. The condition: reverse charge mechanism shall not apply if. That means by default it is under reverse charge mechanism. Now this reverse charge mechanism shall not apply if author opts to take registration and gives a declaration to the jurisdictional commissioner before the commencement of financial year. So the declaration shall be given before the commencement of the financial year that he shall pay the taxes under forward charge mechanism and will do all the compliances. Such option shall not be withdrawn for a period of 1 year from the date of exercising the option. The author makes a declaration on the invoice issued to the publisher. So author would also mention the invoice that the taxes are being paid under forward charge mechanism. So now friends, the conditions are: the author should be registered, and after taking registration he should give a declaration to the jurisdictional commissioner. Just because he is a registered person, an author could be registered for so many reasons. He could have a commercial property which has given on rent, on which taxes are liable to be paid under forward charge mechanism. Just because the author is registered, it doesn't mean the royalty which is being received will be taxed under forward charge mechanism. The author has to be registered and he has to give a declaration to the jurisdictional commissioner. And when should this declaration be given? It should be given before the commencement of the financial year. And the such option which is being exercised, it cannot be withdrawn for a period of 1 year from the date of exercising the said option. So now friends, what is the implication? What is the implication of he gives a declaration to the jurisdictional commissioner before the commencement of financial year and he shall pay the taxes under forward charge mechanism and do all the compliances? Such options shall not be withdrawn for a period of 1 year. So now friends, since this is effectively come not from 1st of April, this has come from 1st of October 2019. This notification has come from 1st of October 2019. Let's say on 1st of October 2019, a registered author gives a declaration that he will pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. Now friends, the point is, if he gives a declaration on 1st of October 2019 that he will pay taxes under forward charge mechanism, can he come outside? Can he come outside by 31st March 2020 and from 1st of April 2020 let the publisher pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism? Is this scenario possible? I'll repeat the events again. From 1st of October 2019, the registered author gives a declaration that the taxes will be paid by him under forward charge mechanism. Now the question is, by 31st March 2020, can he come outside and ask the publisher to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism? Now let's read it again. Author opts to take registration and gives a declaration to the jurisdictional commissioner before the commencement of financial year that he shall pay the taxes under FCM and do all the compliances. Such option shall not be withdrawn for a period of 1 year from the date of exercising the option. So now friends, since he has given the option on 1st of October 2019, he cannot come outside on or before 31st of March 2020 because 1 year has not lapsed. So therefore, from 1st of October 2019 till 30th of September 2020, till such time, if he has given a declaration, he has to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. He has to pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. And let's say, come 1st of October 2020, comes 1st of October 2020, on 1st of October 2020, can he come outside? Can he come outside and ask the publisher to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism? To that, the answer is yes. Now friends, please read carefully. Here it tells you, opting alone you have to do before the commencement of financial year. If you want to enter into a forward charge mechanism, that has to happen before the commencement of financial year. Exiting from the forward charge mechanism can happen at any point of time in the mid of the financial year, but provided it should be more than 1 year. Because here the condition tells you it cannot be withdrawn for a period of 1 year from the date of exercising the option. If the period of 1 year is over and thereafter if he wants to come outside that forward charge mechanism at any point of time during the financial year, that is possible. So friends, the only point which you need to remember is, by default it is under reverse charge mechanism. If the author opts to take registration, point number one. After taking registration, point number two, he has to give a declaration that he will pay taxes under forward charge mechanism. That is permissible. Now, friends, the next question is, can the author take credit? Can the author take credit? Friends, as we discussed, books are exempted. So, author, let's assume, author opts to take registration and pays taxes under forward charge mechanism. Author raises an invoice on the publisher, charging GST at 12%. Publisher cannot take credit because books are exempted. Now, however, since author is paying taxes under forward charge mechanism, if the author, please concentrate, if the author is having any credits, that can of course be utilized for payment of this royalty, for payment of GST on this royalty. Let's take a few examples. Vijay is an author who is not registered under GST. He writes a book on indirect taxes and permits the usage of its copyright to taxman, a publication house. Now, friends, since this author is not registered, by default, it will continue to remain under reverse charge mechanism. So, it is going to be reverse charge. Vijay is an author who is registered under GST. He writes a book on indirect taxes. So, he is a registered person. And he permits the usage of its copyright to taxman, a publication house. He has not exercised the option to pay taxes under forward charge. Now, friends, just because the author is registered, it doesn't mean. Just because the author is registered, it doesn't mean it will go away from RCM and come to FCM. He has to be registered and he has to give a declaration. So, it will continue to remain under RCM. RCM is applicable. Vijay is an author who is registered under GST. He writes a book on indirect taxes and permits the usage of its copyright to taxman publication house. He has exercised the option to pay taxes under forward charge. So now, friends, here RCM is not applicable and it is going to be taxed under forward charge mechanism. I'm sure you're clear with these cases. The next, it is a new entry in the reverse charge notification. Service renting of motor vehicle. Now, friends, before we go further, we'll just discuss the rate of taxes which is applicable on renting of motor vehicle so that we'll be able to appreciate this entry in a much better manner. So, for renting of motor vehicle, there are two rates of taxes. One, it is 5%. The other one, it is 18%. Renting of motor vehicle, 5%, it is without input tax credit with one exception. 5% without input tax credit with one exception is that input tax credit will be available as regards as inward supplies of same line of business is concerned. So, 5% without ITC, exception is ITC of input services is allowed if it is of same line of business. Now, what do we mean by that? Let's suppose I am a person who is engaged in the business of renting of motor vehicle. Now, I take an office on rent, I pay GST on the rent which is paid to my landlord, GST is being charged on it. I have opted to pay GST at 5% on my outward supplies of renting of motor vehicle. Can I take credit of the GST which is charged on the commercial rent? The answer is no, because I have opted for 5% without ITC. Now, friends, this renting of motor vehicle, this car which I am letting it out, let's say to a customer, currently I am not having that car. I know another person who is into the same line of business and I take a car on rent from him and I further give it on rent. So, essentially, I am subcontracting the work. So, now that person is going to charge me GST. Can I take that credit? The answer is yes. That credit is allowed in this rate notification. So, friends, if it is 5%, it is without input tax credit. Only one credit is allowed. That credit is input tax credit of input services from the same line of business. Now, friends, you get to know a new thing over here. Input tax credit will not be allowed in what circumstances? I'm just discussing a general point, not about this reverse charge. Input tax credit will not be allowed if it is used exclusively for making an exempt supply, if it is used for non-business purposes, if it is blocked under 17 subsection 5, input tax credit will not be allowed. In addition to this, you need to add one more. That one more is, rate notification can also restrict your input tax credit. Now, friends, this input tax credit which is restricted, renting of a motor vehicle. I am giving a motor vehicle on rent and I am paying GST on the commercial rent which I am paying for my office. Here, this supply of service which I am making, it is taxable, it is for business purposes, and this GST which I have paid on commercial rent of my building, it is not blocked under 17 subsection 5. Friends, please don't get confused. Renting of motor vehicle, this outward supply of mine will be an inward supply of somebody else. For him, it might be blocked. For him, the credit of GST paid on motor vehicle might be blocked for the recipient. For him, it is an inward supply. But now from my point of view, I am engaged in the business of giving motor vehicle on rent. And I have got certain credits. I have got GST which is paid on the building rent. Now, is this GST, this inward supply, is it used for making a taxable supply? Yes. Is it for business purposes? Yes. Is it blocked under 17 subsection 5? The answer is no. It is not blocked under 17 subsection 5. So credit is allowed. However, I am not taking the credit because rate notification is not allowing me. So the rate notification number 11/2017, central tax rate tells me if you want a lower rate of 5%, you cannot take any credit excepting that credit of inward supplies which is coming from the same line of business. However, if you want to take credits, you have to pay GST at the rate of 18%. So if I choose to pay GST at the rate of 18%, whatever GST which is being charged on the rent, that I am eligible to take. So now friends, with this background, let's move further. What is the new addition in the reverse charge notification? The service is renting of a motor vehicle. Now who should be the supplier? Supplier should be any person other than a body corporate. Please concentrate. Supplier should be any person other than a body corporate who's paying central tax at the rate of 2.5%. So friends, as we discussed, there are two rates. Now we discussed the two rates of 5% and 18%. This 5% is CGST 2.5 and SGST 2.5, 5%. So that is why it is telling you who's paying CGST, central tax at the rate of 2.5% on renting of motor vehicle with ITC only of input services in same line of business. So friends, essentially it is telling if there is any supplier who's supplying renting of motor vehicle services to a body corporate and if he's paying GST at the rate of 5% without ITC, with only ITC of input services from the same line of business, then this 5% is liable to be paid by the body corporate under reverse charge mechanism. Please read this carefully. It is in this segment you will get all your answers. So we'll take questions now, which is going to be based only on these sentences. So the recipient is going to be a body corporate who is located in the taxable territory. So friends, this is again before you. This is very, very important. Any person other than a body corporate who should be the supplier for renting of motor vehicle services to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism, the supplier has to be any person other than a body corporate who is paying central tax at the rate of 2.5% on renting of motor vehicle with ITC only of input services of same line of business. Now let's go. Mr. Basha is renting out his motor vehicle to a partnership firm. Now friends, RCM will apply only if the recipient happens to be body corporate. RCM is not applicable. Basha Private Limited is renting his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited. Now friends, who should be the supplier? The supplier should be a person other than the body corporate and the recipient should be a body corporate. In this example, the recipient, although it is a body corporate, but the supplier is also a body corporate. So therefore, RCM will not apply. It is liable to be taxed under forward charge mechanism. Basha is an unregistered person. He is renting his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited. This is a very, very important scenario. If you have understood these wordings, you will be able to answer whether this is taxable under RCM or it is taxable under FCM. Let's have a relook at it. Mr. Basha is an unregistered person. So friends, who is the supplier? Is he other than a body corporate? Answer is yes. Have you satisfied the condition? Yes. Rents his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited. Who is the recipient? Recipient, is he a body corporate? Yes. Have you satisfied the condition? Yes. Is it liable to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism? The answer is no. The answer is no because please read the wordings again. It tells you any person other than a body corporate agreed paying central tax at the rate of 2.5%. Please understand, friends, it is paying central tax at the rate of 2.5%. Now, when would a person pay central tax? Only when he is a registered person. Friends, here, although they have not used the wordings, any registered person other than body corporate. Please concentrate the wordings. Please concentrate the language which is used by the lawmaker. Here, although they have not mentioned the wordings, any registered person other than the body corporate, but still it is implied because it tells you any person other than the body corporate paying central tax at the rate of 2.5%. That means, when do you call him as paying central tax at the rate of 2.5%? Only when he is registered. Only when he is registered, he would pay central tax at the rate of 2.5%. So, here also reverse charge is not applicable because he is an unregistered person. I'm sure you're able to appreciate this, friends. Even though expressly the lawmaker has not used the words registered person, still it is implied because they have qualified this person along with paying a central tax at the rate of 2.5%. Mr. Basha is a registered person. He is renting his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited and he charges 12% GST. So now, friends, Mr. Basha is a registered person. He is renting his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited. So now, friends, he is registered. Supplier is a registered person and he is not a body corporate. This condition is satisfied. The recipient is a body corporate. This condition is also satisfied. But still, it is going to be under forward charge mechanism because only if the supplier is paying taxes at 2.5%, only then it is under RCM. If the supplier has opted to pay taxes with taking the benefit of input tax credit at the rate of, it is 18%, at the rate of 18%, in such cases, not liable to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism, it is to be taxed under forward charge mechanism. Mr. Basha is a registered person. He is renting his motor vehicle to Infosys Private Limited. He has opted to pay 5% GST without input tax credit. Now, this is the scenario where all your conditions are being satisfied. Supplier is a person other than body corporate. Recipient is a body corporate and he is paying taxes at the rate of 5%. So, therefore, this is the only case which fits into reverse charge mechanism. So, now, friends, what is the conclusion? Let's suppose you are carrying out the audit of a body corporate. Let's say you are carrying out an audit of a body corporate. Now, during the audit, you see an invoice. During the audit, you notice an invoice which is renting of motor vehicle. This body corporate has received these services from a supplier who is not a body corporate. The supplier is not a body corporate, it is a renting of motor vehicle and the recipient happens to be a body corporate and the supplier is an unregistered person. Scenario number one, the supplier is an unregistered person. In such cases, the body corporate is not liable to pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. Point number two, this supplier is a registered person. This supplier is a registered person and he is charging you GST at the rate of 18%. Again, it is forward charge mechanism. Scenario number three, please be very, very careful. The supplier is a registered person and he is not a body corporate and he is paying GST at the rate of 5%. And on the invoice also, he charges you 5%. Please concentrate. The supplier is not a body corporate. He is a registered person. He is paying taxes at the rate of 5% and on the invoice also he has charged this body corporate 5%. Is this invoice correct in law? The answer is no. The answer is no because, friends, this 5% is not under forward charge mechanism. Now, this supplier of service of renting of motor vehicle, he cannot collect this 5% from the recipient because the recipient is liable to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism to the government. So, friends, the point is as regards as a registered person who is paying taxes at the rate of 5% and who is not a body corporate, he will have two sets of invoices. He will have two categories of invoices. Friends, please concentrate. The two categories of invoices, the condition is registered person who is not a body corporate. Registered person who is not a body corporate and he is giving renting of motor vehicle services and he is paying taxes at the rate of 5%. That means he is not taking any credit other than the input services of same line of business. He would have two categories of invoices. One invoices he will give to his recipients other than body corporate, where he will charge 5%. And another category of invoice which he will give to body corporate clients, where he will not pay 5% on the invoice. He will mention taxes at the rate of 5% needs to be paid by the recipient body corporate. So friends, wherever during your audit you find an invoice, this is the most common mistake which happens. Wherever during the audit if you find an invoice of renting of motor vehicle by a person who is registered, who is not a body corporate, the recipient of services happens to be body corporate, there should not be any 5% charged on the invoice. The reason being, it is taxable under reverse charge mechanism. You pay him 5%, he gives you a bill of 100 plus 5. You pay him 105, again you are liable to pay taxes under reverse charge mechanism. So you have to instruct that if he is a registered person other than body corporate, he should not charge GST on his invoice. He should mention taxes payable under reverse charge mechanism. The next entry is lending of securities. So services of lending of securities under securities lending scheme of securities of SEBI. Who is the service provider? The service provider is a lender. He is a person who deposits the securities registered in his name or in any other person's name duly authorized on his behalf with the intermediary for the purpose of lending under the scheme of SEBI. The service recipient is a borrower. He is a person who borrows the securities under the scheme through an approved intermediary of SEBI. Now friends, as regards as securities is concerned, having read this, I'll just give you a brief background. As regards as securities is concerned, if the securities are disposed, that means if the securities are sold, in such case, it is neither goods nor services, because from the definition of goods, money and securities is outside. From the definition of services as well, money and securities are outside. So therefore, if the securities are being sold, since they are neither goods nor they are services, there is no GST liability on sale of securities. However, if the securities are given on rent, that means if they are lended. Now, how can securities be lended? Now, the lending of securities is monitored by SEBI. It happens through an intermediary and it happens through a faceless transaction. That means the lender doesn't know the borrower and the borrower doesn't know the lender. It happens through an intermediary and it happens through a recognized stock exchange where the borrower and lender don't know each other. So these securities are lended for a particular period of time for which the lender is going to charge his rent for the purpose of lending of securities. After a stipulated time, those securities, equivalent amount of securities which were taken on rent, needs to be given back by the borrower to the lender. So this happens through an exchange, recognized stock exchange. It happens through an intermediary. Now this rental payment which is given by the borrower to the lender, it is liable to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism wherein the borrower needs to pay GST. Now friends, as we already discussed here, it happens through an interface. It happens through a recognized stock exchange where the borrower and lender do not know each other. So in such a case, agreed that it is liable to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism. But what is the nature of GST which needs to be paid? Is it CGST / SGST needs to be paid, or is it IGST which needs to be paid? Now friends, had the location of supplier been known, now it is the borrower, that is the recipient of services. He is receiving securities, he is taking the securities on rent and he is paying a rental amount. Now he is a recipient of service who is liable to pay GST under RCM. Now this recipient of service doesn't know the location of the supplier. He does not know the location of supplier. And without knowing the location of supplier, you cannot conclude the nature of supply. You cannot conclude whether it is an intrastate supply or an interstate supply. So therefore, it is liable to be taxed under reverse charge mechanism and IGST needs to be paid in all the cases because the location of supplier is not known by the recipient. So friends, it is a very simple case. The lender giving securities on rent to the borrower. Borrower pays IGST under RCM. Next, there's a circular for valuation. Let's take the example directly. Circular number 101/21/2019. Interest for payment in installments. Now let's say an example, you want to purchase a mobile phone, let's say it's priced at ₹40,000. So option number one, you can go to the shop directly, pay ₹40,000 and outright purchase the mobile phone. You can go to the shop, let's say you go to Chennai Mobiles, pay ₹40,000 and purchase the mobile outright. Option number two, Chennai Mobiles, the supplier of the mobile phone himself gives you an option to make payments in installments. So the price of the mobile phone is ₹40,000. He allows you to pay it in 4 installments, 1 month each installment. He allows you to pay it in 4 installments of, let's say, for an example, 11,000 per installment. So now friends, the cost of the mobile phone is ₹40,000. In total, you are going to pay ₹44,000. ₹4,000 is interest. So interest charged by the supplier is ₹4,000. Cost of the phone or the sale value of the phone is ₹40,000. In total, you pay ₹44,000. This could be second modus operandi. Third one, Chennai Mobiles doesn't give you an option to purchase the mobile phone in installments. However, in the Chennai Mobiles shop, there's a counter of Bajaj FinServ. He's an independent supplier. He's an independent person. There's a counter of Bajaj FinServ in the shop of Chennai Mobiles. Now, Chennai Mobiles doesn't have this option of receiving the payment in installments. However, there's a service provider at the counter who tells that he will arrange the finance for you to purchase the mobile phone. So Bajaj FinServ will pay ₹40,000 to Chennai Mobiles. Chennai Mobiles will give the phone to you. You will have to pay 11,000 rupees in 4 installments, totaling to ₹44,000 to Bajaj FinServ. So now this ₹44,000 is going to Bajaj FinServ. So this transaction is actually, you purchase the mobile phone on a loan. Bajaj FinServ has given you a loan of ₹40,000. You are repaying ₹44,000. ₹4,000 is the interest income to Bajaj FinServ. So now friends, this is the modus operandi of the transactions, what you can do. You can have an outright purchase. You can purchase on installments from the supplier himself. You can purchase the equipment on loan from an independent supplier. Now friends, we are not bothered about situation number one. Situation number one is very clear. There is no interest element which is involved at all. So outright, the value of supply happens to be 40,000, taxable ₹40,000. Scenario number two and scenario number three. Scenario number two is a scenario where the supplier himself is arranging for a finance. He is allowing you to pay in installments and he is earning the interest income. Scenario number three, here the supplier is not arranging for the finance. There is another person who is giving you a loan of ₹40,000 and he is earning interest income. Now in both these scenarios, scenario number two as well as scenario number three, if you are delaying the payment of installment, scenario number two and in scenario number three, if you are delaying the payment of any installment, there is a penal interest of ₹500 which is going to be charged. So let's say the due is on or before 10th of the subsequent month. Each month, 10th, on or before 10th, you're supposed to pay the dues. Now, in case if there is any delay in payment of dues, an additional interest for delay in payment of that interest and penal interest or additional interest to the extent of ₹500 is going to be charged. So now friends, the question is, in either of these scenarios, scenario number two and scenario number three. Scenario number two, the supplier himself is the financier. Scenario number three, supplier of the mobile phone is different, financier of the mobile phone is different. What is the treatment? What is the GST implication, or is there any GST liability upon this ₹500 which is being charged as the penal interest or additional interest. Now friends, this question arises because, is this 500 rupees which is being charged, is this 500 rupees which is being charged, is it for the purpose of tolerating an act because you paid the consideration in a delayed manner, because you paid the installments in a delayed manner? So there is a activity of tolerating that act of you paying it in a delayed manner, and for that toleration a 500 rupees is being charged. If it is so, then this 500 rupees, it becomes an independent supply of service of tolerating the act. This 4000 rupees is for the purpose of interest, and 40,000 rupees is for mobile phone. Now we are going to evaluate all these three elements in these two different scenarios: the sale of mobile phone, the interest which is being charged, and the penal fees or the penal interest which is being charged for the delayed payment of consideration. Now friends, first let us take the last scenario, that is, the supplier is a different person and the person who is financing the phone, in our example Bajaj Finserv, he is a different person. Now what could be the implication? Now friends, as regards as the mobile phone is concerned, so here Chennai Mobiles supplies the mobile phone at 40,000 rupees. We are speaking at scenario number 3. He is not entering into any finance arrangement. He gives the mobile phone, he receives 40,000 rupees. GST is paid on 40,000 rupees, the matter is over as regards as the mobile phone is concerned. Now, Bajaj Finserv is financing this mobile phone. So he pays 40,000 rupees to Chennai Mobiles on behalf of the buyer. And now the buyer is supposed to pay 44,000 rupees to Bajaj Finserv. Now, in this 44,000 rupees, 40,000 rupees is the principal, 4,000 rupees is interest. 4,000 rupees is in interest. And let's say in any one of the installments, he has made a delayed payment and for which 500 rupees additional interest or penal interest is being charged. What is going to be the tax treatment for this 4,000 rupees interest, which is the consideration for Bajaj Finserv, and 500 rupees penal interest or additional interest? I repeat, there are three elements: mobile phone 40,000, interest 4,000, penal interest 500 rupees. Mobile phone 40,000 rupees, the matter is over. It is a supply of mobile phone by Chennai Mobiles. It is not anywhere related to this financing arrangement. So tax which is applicable on the mobile phones is paid on 40,000 rupees. 4,000 rupees is the interest, 500 rupees is the penal interest for Bajaj Finserv. 40,000 rupees is repayment of loan which will not attract GST. Only the interest portion, we have to see what is the GST liability on it. So now friends, scenario number 3 we are talking about, where interest is charged by an independent supplier. In our example, it is Bajaj Finserv. Now in this case, the main interest of 4,000 rupees which is there, it is exempted. It is exempted by exemption notification number 12/2017, central tax rate. There is an exemption for the main interest. How about penal interest of rupees 500 in our example? Now friends, let's read the wordings of the exemption notification. What do they mean by interest? Interest is of course exempted. Now any interest which is being charged as a consideration for advancing money, that is exempted. They have defined what is interest. So interest means interest payable in any manner in respect of any money is borrowed or a debt incurred, including deposit claim or other similar right or obligation, but it doesn't include any service fee or other charge. This interest amount will not include any service fee or other charge in respect of the monies borrowed or debt incurred or in respect of any credit facility which has not been utilized. So now friends, as regards as any service fee or other charge is concerned, now say for the purpose of this processing this loan by Bajaj Finserv, 40,000 rupees the loan amount which is given, let's say there is some processing charges of 1,000 rupees which is being charged. Let us say 40,000 rupees is the cost of the mobile phone, 4,000 rupees is interest, 500 rupees is penal interest, and in addition to this there is some 1,000 rupees some application fees or some processing charges which is being charged by Bajaj Finserv. That 1,000 rupees will not form a part of interest and that will be taxable. So this is what it is telling: interest will not include any service fee or other charge. So we are clear about it. So 4,000 rupees is interest, it is exempted. 1,000 rupees, had there been any processing fees, that will not be interest, that will be taxable separately. How about the penal interest or the interest which is there, which is the additional interest for delayed payment of installments? Can you fit it into other charges? Can you say this is other charges and it is not included in the interest, therefore it becoming taxable? The answer is no. So now friends, here it tells you any service fee or other charges, this other charges has to be read along with service fee. So other charges similar to service fee, the processing fee, any other charges which are similar to service fee, this other charges has to be read along with service fee. Only that is not included in interest. This penal interest is also interest only. Even otherwise, if you take a different view, any interest, late fee or penalty which is charged for delayed payment of consideration will be included in the value of supply if you look into section 15 subsection 2 clause D. Any interest, late fee or penalty which is charged for delayed payment of consideration will be included in the value of main supply itself. Now friends, as regards as Bajaj Finserv is concerned, what is the value of main supply? The value of main supply is 4,000. 40,000 loan given, 44,000 received. So 40,000, out of this 44,000, 40,000 is towards repayment of loan. So which is a transaction in money, it is outside GST. The balance 4,000 rupees, is it a supply of service? The answer is yes. Extending money for consideration in the form of interest, it happens to be a supply of service, although exempted, but still it is a supply of service. And what is the value? The value of the service is the interest amount which is being charged. So now friends, basic interest amount which is being charged is 4,000 rupees and 500 rupees for delay in payment of this 4,000 rupees. For delay in payment of installments, for delay in payment of this 4,000 rupees, the installment will include the interest portion also. So for delay in payment of this 4,000 rupees, an additional 500 rupees which is being charged, this will not have an independent identity of its own. It will go and it will be included in the value of main supply itself. Here in this case, it is interest. So therefore, this penal interest will not be an independent supply. It will go and form a part of the main supply itself. Now, since main supply is exempted, this additional interest which is charged for delayed payment of the consideration, that is delayed payment of this 4,000, this also will be exempted. This is argument number one. Argument number two is this 500 rupees is also interest only. This 500 rupees penal interest or other interest, additional interest which is being charged, this is also interest only. It cannot be called as other charges. Here it will be included in the definition of interest only. Other charges means other charges which are similar to service fee or processing fees. That alone is not included in the definition of interest. So this also is interest only. So any penal interest or additional interest is again interest only. So penal interest is also exempted. So friends, as regards as this Bajaj Finserv is concerned, any processing fee taxable, basic interest amount exempted, additional interest, penal interest for delay in payment of installments also exempted. Scenario number two, what we had discussed. Out of three scenarios, we have already seen scenario number three of Bajaj Finserv. Scenario number two, wherein Chennai Mobiles himself arranged for the finance. So therefore, the cost of the mobile phone was 40,000 rupees. Now, it will be repaid in 4 equal installments of 11,000 rupees, totaling to 44,000 rupees. Now friends, as regards as this 44,000 rupees is concerned, now there is no Bajaj Finserv in picture. Here, 40,000 rupees cost of the mobile phone, 4,000 rupees is the interest amount. Let's say mobile phone is taxable at 18%. Now, 500 rupees you have delayed in repayment of any one installment. So 500 rupees penal interest is being charged. 500 rupees additional interest or penal interest is being charged for the delayed payment of consideration. So now friends, as regards as main interest is concerned for Chennai Mobiles. So now friends, here if you remember section 15 subsection 2 clause D, interest, late fee or penalty which is charged for delayed payment of consideration will be included in the main value of supply. So now friends, here the main value of supply is 40,000 rupees as regards as Chennai Mobiles is concerned. This additional 4,000 rupees is for what? It is for delay in payment of this 40,000 rupees. It is a financial arrangement. delay in payment of this 40,000 rupees payment in installments. So therefore, this additional 4,000 rupees is being charged. So therefore, this 4,000 rupees interest here, it will not be exempted, because here it is not an independent supply. It will go and form a part of the main value of supply. Kindly differentiate this with the example of Bajaj Finserv. For Bajaj Finserv, this 4,000 rupees also was exempted, because with this 4,000 rupees itself was the main supply. Bajaj Finserv did not supply mobile phones. Mobile phones was supplied by Chennai Mobiles to the user. Bajaj Finserv financed it. It paid 40,000 rupees. The mobile phone was purchased by the buyer. 44,000 rupees will be paid to Bajaj Finserv. 4,000 rupees is the main consideration for Bajaj Finserv, and that is exempted because that is interest. Here the value of main supply itself is 4,000 rupees. But over here, for Chennai Mobiles, it is making a value of supply at 40,000 rupees. Now, 4,000 rupees is being charged for delay in payment of consideration. It is a finance arrangement which is given by Chennai Mobiles himself. So therefore, this 4,000 interest late fee or penalty, which is charged for delayed payment of consideration, will also be included in the value of main supply itself. So this main interest is not exempt as interest, because by virtue of 15 subsection 2 clause D, it goes into the value of main supply. 500 rupees, same logic will be extended. Even for this 500 rupees, it doesn't have an independent nature of its own. It goes and fits into the value of main supply, the value of mobile phone. So the entire 44,000 rupees 500 will be taxable at the rate of 18% when the finance arrangement is given by Chennai Mobiles itself. However, if it is given by Bajaj Finserv, as seen in the previous example, GST will be charged only on 40,000 rupees at 80%. This is a supply of mobile phone by Chennai Mobiles to the buyer. The difference of 4,500 rupees, it is supply of financial services by Bajaj Finserv to the buyer. This 4,500 rupees as interest, it is exempted. In this case, where Chennai Mobile himself is financing, this 4,500 is not an independent interest. It forms a part of the main value of supply of 40,000 rupees. So it is not exempt at interest. So friends, what do we conclude? We conclude as the additional interest or the penal interest on the overdue loan. If you're making any delay in repayment of the overdue loan, and if the additional interest or penal interest is being charged, it has got no independent identity. That means you cannot call it as though it is being charged for tolerating an act of delayed payment. That is not the case. If that is the case, it happens to be an independent supply of service. Here, whatever additional interest or penal interest is being charged on overdue loan, it is not an independent identity. It goes and sits into the value of main supply. Now, if Chennai Mobiles himself is doing the finance arrangements, it will go and sit in the value of main supply, that is the value of mobile phone. If the finance arrangement is done by Bajaj Finserv, here the value of main supply for Bajaj Finserv is 4,000 rupees. This penal interest will go and sit along with 4,000 rupees. So in case of Bajaj Finserv, this 500 rupees will be exempted. In case of Chennai Mobiles, this 500 rupees will be taxable because mobile phone was taxable. As regards as the main interest is concerned, for Bajaj Finserv, it is exempted. For Chennai Mobiles, it will be taxable because it will go and sit in the value of main supply. Passenger service fee, user development fees. Now friends, to understand both these terminologies, let's spend a few minutes. Now friends, there's an airport. This airport is actually maintained. This airport is actually maintained by an operator. Say for example, the operator is Airport Authority of India. So Airport Authority of India is responsible for the infrastructure and the maintenance of the airport. Let's suppose the airport of Coimbatore. Now this is maintained. The infrastructure and the maintenance is the responsibility of Airport Authority of India. Now this airport is used by airlines as well as the passengers. The airlines to supply services of transportation of goods and passengers. The passengers for using the services which are provided by the airlines. Now friends, as regards as Airport Authority of India is concerned, it is going to collect some amount from the passengers. It is going to collect some amount from the passengers in the form of passenger service fees and user developmental fees for infrastructural activities which is being carried out at the airport. So here we go. What are they? According to Rule 88 of the aircraft rules, it tells you Airport licensee, that is your Airport Authority of India, the operator, the airport licensee may collect PSF from embarking passengers at the rate which are prescribed by the central government. It shall be utilized for the infrastructure and facilitation of passengers. What is user developmental fees? Airport licensee may collect the same from the major airport. No specific purpose is given. So here it is according to rule 89 of aircraft rules. So friends, we are not bothered about the rules of aircraft rules. What we are concerned is this passenger service fee and user developmental fees is collected from the passengers. That means passengers are supposed to pay PSF and UDF to whom? Not to the airlines. They are liable to pay. They are liable to pay to the Airport Authority of India, that is the airport operator. But what is the collection mechanism? What is the collection mechanism? The collection mechanism is these levies, these passengers do not pay it directly to the Airport Authority of India or directly to the airport operator. As a measure of facilitation, as a measure of convenience, the airlines collect this amount of PSF and UDF from the passengers, and as it is, they hand it over to the operator. Now, the airlines act as an agent. They collect the amount from the passengers and give it to the operator. So friends, this is how it works. Now, the GST liability. Is there a GST liability on passenger service fee and user developmental fee? Friends, who is the service provider? As regards as these two fees are concerned, the service provider is not the airline. Although it is collecting, it is acting only as an agent. It is not the airline, it is the operator. So the service provider, in our example, let's say Airport Authority of India, and the service recipient happens to be the passenger, be the user. Is there a GST liability on this PSF and UDF? The answer is yes, because for what purposes are they collected? There is a contractual reciprocity. They are going to pay this sum, and this sum is going to be used for developmental of airport. And it is not tax. Please understand, this PSF and UDF is not tax. It is a fee which is levied by the airport operator and not the government. So yes, it's not a tax. It is collected by the airport licensee. Moreover, there is reciprocity. It is being paid for a fixed purpose, that is for infrastructural development. What is the collection mechanism? For facilitation, the airlines collect from the passengers and remit it to the operator. But the airlines will charge a consideration of, say, 5 rupees for such collection. Now friends, this airlines is going to charge from whom? From the passenger? The answer is no. The airlines is going to charge from the authority. That means Airport Authority of India. For what reason? They are collecting from the passenger and giving it to the operator for supplying these services of collection and remitting the amount. This is a supply of service for which they are going to charge a separate consideration, let's say of 5 rupees. So friends, I'm sure you're clear with the facts now. The facts are, there's an airport authority, the airport operator charges PSF and UDF from the passengers. The collection mechanism is the passengers pay to the airlines pay to the operator, for which the airlines is going to charge a collection fee of say rupees 5 from the operator. Question number one, is there a GST? Who's the service supplier? The service supplier is airport operator. For this PSF and UDF, who is the service supplier? It is the airport operator. Who is the service recipient? It is the passenger. How does the passenger pay? He pays it through the airlines. Through the airlines, he pays it to airport operator. Is it leviable to GST, this PSF and UDF? The answer is yes. Now, there is another supply of service. One supply of service is from the airport operator to the passenger in the form of PSF and UDF, which is a supply of service. There is another supply of service from the airlines to the operator. From airlines to the operator, that is Airport Authority of India, to this operator, there's a service. What is that service? The service of collecting this PSF and UDF for a consideration of say rupees 5 as collection charges. So I'm sure you're clear with the facts so far. Should the airlines charge GST on PSF or UDF? Friends, what is the collection mechanism? Airlines will be collecting this PSF and UDF from the passengers on their ticket. They will collect this and then they will pay it to the authority, the Airport Authority of India. Now, on this charge which is being made by the airlines to the passenger, should GST be levied on this? Please understand, the ticket will say transportation charges so and so. It will further say PSF and UDF so and so. Now, on PSF and UDF, whatever is the levy which is being collected by the airlines only as an agent, should also that be included in the value of supply of transportation charges? and GST be paid on the entire sum. This is option number one. Say transportation charges, let's say it is 4000 rupees and this PSF and UDF, it works out to 500 rupees. Should GST be paid on 4500 rupees? Or 4000 rupees is the transportation charges, 500 rupees the airlines is acting as a pure agent. It is merely acting as an agent. It will collect 500 and pay 500 to authority. It is not supplying any service for receiving this 500 from the customer, from the passenger. From the authority, it will collect 5 rupees on which GST will be chargeable. That is agreeable. Now, when it is collecting 4,500 from the passengers, question number one, whether GST is to be charged on 4,500 or GST is to be charged only on 4,000 rupees. So, this 500 rupees can be excluded if the airlines, let's suppose Indigo is collecting 4,500 rupees. Now, to remove this 500 rupees, Indigo will be eligible for removing this 500 rupees if it is satisfying the condition of pure agent. Any exclusions available? Let's see what does pure agent tell you. So, rule 33, you have to satisfy certain conditions for you to fit into a pure agent. See, logically, Indigo is a pure agent because it is not supplying any services. It is receiving from the passenger, remitting it to the airline authority, your airport authority of India. So, now, it enters into a contractual agreement. Yes, there is a contractual agreement. It doesn't hold any title to the goods or services. It doesn't do. It does not use it for its own interest. No. It receives only the actual amount incurred in addition to the amount received for supplies affected by him. Now, friends, here, do you see any violation of the condition? It is also receiving 5 rupees extra. The answer is no. It is not receiving 5 rupees extra from the passenger. It receives 400 from the passenger or 500 from the passenger, whatever in the example it was there. It receives 500 rupees from the passenger and gives it to Indigo as it is. It is not collecting anything extra from the passenger. Now, it is collecting a collection charges of 5 rupees, but that is from the Airport Authority of India. It is not from the passenger. As regards as passenger is concerned, whatever is the exact fee which is being paid, only that is being collected. It is satisfying this condition also. Payment is made by pure agent on authorization from the recipient. Yes, payment made by the pure agent has been separately indicated in the invoice. It has to show that user developmental fees or passenger service fee separately in the invoice. The supplies are procured by the pure agent from the third party are in addition to the supplies made on his own account. Yes, they are not only collecting PSF and UDF, they are actually supplying transportation services. In addition to that, as a facilitation measure, it is also collecting passenger service fee and user developmental fees. So, it is satisfying all the conditions of a pure agent. So, therefore, should airlines charge GST on PSF or UDF? The answer is no. Airlines is collecting the amount in the capacity of pure agent. Friends, if you take a deeper look, whatever this PSF or UDF, if you understand this logic, you have understood the entire circular. Whatever this PSF and UDF is being collected through airlines. It is actually charged by whom? It is charged by Airport Authority of India. Paid by whom? By the passenger. The airline, the Indigo, is a mere intermediary. He is only a pure agent. So, the service supplier for this PSF and UDF is Airport Authority of India. Service recipient is the passenger. This PSF and UDF, is it leviable to GST? The answer is yes. So, whatever the amount which is being collected through this airlines of this PSF and UDF will already be inclusive of GST. Because it is a supply of service by the Airport Authority of India to the passenger, where the Airport Authority of India has to pay GST on this amount. So, now whatever this extra amount is being collected by the airlines acting as a pure agent, this includes GST for the service supplied by the Airport Authority of India to the passenger. So, why again charge GST on that? And even otherwise, he happens to be a pure agent. He collects that amount and remits it to the Airport Authority. So, here airlines is collecting the amount in the capacity of a pure agent. Should airlines charge GST on PSF UDF? The answer is no. You can take an example. You can have this invoice before you. This invoice is issued by Indigo Airlines, where you can see air travel and related charges. They say 4427 is the taxable value. The rate of IGST is 5%. So, 212 is the GST amount. Total amount including taxes is 4459. Airport charges. They have mentioned airport charges. Let's look at the definition of airport charges which is given below. Airport charges includes UDF and PSF. So it is including your user developmental fee and passenger service fee. So this airport charges is basically nothing but whatever is going to be paid to the airport operator. So it tells you it includes UDF, PSF and other airport charges collected on behalf of airport operator as applicable. That means it is collecting only the exact amount. So now this airport charges, here it is 583 rupees it is collecting, and if you see carefully, they have mentioned this in the column of non-taxable. That means they are acting as a pure agent, but they have to separately indicate it in the invoice to claim the exemption of pure agent. So now 583 rupees on this, you can see there is no GST and totaling to 583 rupees. But friends, this 583 rupees, who is the service supplier? It is Airport Authority of India. Who is the service recipient? It is the passenger. So on this 583 rupees, should GST be paid by Airport Authority of India? The answer is yes. So this 583 will already be inclusive of GST. So friends, this circular was there to state that IndiGo need not pay any GST on 583 rupees. So who can avail the ITC of GST charged on PSF and UDF? Now this 583 rupees, as we discussed, it will be inclusive of GST. Who can take this credit? Now if the passenger is registered and is satisfying the conditions of taking input tax credit, yes, the passenger can take the credit, because please understand, service provider is the Airport Authority of India, service recipient is the passenger, airlines has got no role in it, it is only a collecting agent. So who can avail the ITC of GST charged on PSF and UDF? It is the registered passengers. Should airlines pay GST on processing fees? Yes. If it is collecting 5 rupees for collection of this 583 rupees and giving it to the airline operator, the Airport Authority of India, the airport operator. In such cases, on this 5 rupees, who has to pay GST? It needs to be paid by the airline. So airline will raise an invoice of 5 rupees plus GST as collection charges. This invoice will go to Airport Authority of India. Can Airport Authority of India take this credit of GST which is charged on this 5 rupees? The answer is yes. So yes, and also airport operator can avail ITC of the same. So friends, I'm sure you're able to follow this. This enhances our understanding about pure agent.
Subscribe to LearnCab and hit the bell icon to get notified.